I'm sorry I couldn't be there in person, but this is a nice substitute for being there in person. I got interested in this subject after I wrote my first boxing book called Max Baer and Barney Ross, Jewish Heroes of Boxing. It led me into investigating other Jewish boxers. And one of the ones that I first came across was a man named Harry Haft, who had been a Holocaust survivor and forced to box in Auschwitz. And that led me to investigate several other boxers who were in the same position. And the first one I encountered was a man named Victor Young Perez, who was a Tunisian Jew, and he and his older brother, known as Kid Perez, had trained to be boxers at a what was called a Maccabee gym in Tunis. And they were both extremely skillful. And Victor decided that his future lay in Paris, not in Tunis. And he moved to Paris and had a number of fights and became the youngest flyweight boxing champion in Europe. I think he was just turning 20 years old at the time. As a flyweight, you can imagine he was quite small. He was 5'1" and probably weighed about 110 pounds. But he was very, very handsome and extremely charismatic. And he had numerous affairs with French movie stars. And the love of his life was a woman who was the leading French movie star of the 1930s. Her name was Mireille Ballon. And they were often photographed together, shopping on the Champs-Élysées, going to nightclubs, going to restaurants. The photographs were in magazines and in newspapers. They became quite a celebrity pair. And however, when the Nazis conquered France, Mireille, being an actress and an opportunist, always looking for the next good part and who could give it to her, decided that her future lay with the Nazis rather than with a Tunisian Jew. And she wound up betraying Victor Young Perez to her Nazi SS lover, a man named Burl Desbach. It sounds a little like Desbach. And upon his betrayal, or following his betrayal, Victor Young Perez was sent to Auschwitz. He thought prior to being arrested that his celebrity would save him from being sent to a concentration camp. And his brother had urged him to return to Tunis because he felt it was less likely for him to suffer in Tunis than in Paris. But Victor didn't pay any attention to his brother. He really believed that his celebrity would serve him well. And from Auschwitz, he was sent to a subcamp called Monowitz, which was run by the IG Farben Chemical Company. And there he was put to work doing quite backbreaking work, as much as 18 hours a day, and malnourished, just given a very thin soup and maybe a crust of bread to eat every day. However, eventually someone recognized him as the flyweight boxing champion. And they said that he had to box in order to entertain the SS troops. And they put him in a ring with an enormous SS guard who was strong, muscular, healthy, well-fed, physically fit, and much larger than Victor. And this SS guard was pummeling him. Victor began to look like a bloody mess after about 10 minutes. However, the SS invited Jewish inmates to come and watch this spectacle. And they told them that they had to keep their heads down. They could look up through their eyes, but only if their heads were down. And if they raised their heads, they would be dragged off to a gas chamber. So they were watching this fellow Jew being beaten up. And they knew that his ring name was Young. And they started a whispering chorus. They were going, Young, Young. And eventually he heard it and it inspired him. And he was able to call upon all of his old boxing skills. And he managed to beat this much larger SS guard. And that inflamed the anger of the other SS guards. And so they managed to continue to set up matches for him. And he had, over the period of time, almost 2 years that he was in Auschwitz, he had 150 bouts, and he won all of them. And when the Allies began to advance on Germany, and there was fear amongst the Nazis of their camps being liberated and evidence being found of their atrocities, they started what were called death marches out of the camp to take these prisoners back to Berlin, and they hoped to put them to work building munitions. And Victor Perez was put on one of these death marches. And as he's marching along the road with other inmates, he saw a stale loaf of bread on the side of the road. And he went to grab the bread, not only to feed himself, but to feed his starving colleagues as well. And an SS guard saw him and picked up a rifle and shot him twice in the back of the head and killed him. Perez was only 33 years old when that happened. And that was January 21st, 1945. The next person I wrote about was a man named Nathan Schapau, who was born in Riga, Latvia. He was a natural athlete. He was a boxer, a wrestler, a football player, a soccer player. He was a large, muscular man, a big bear of a man. And he knew when the Nazis came and took over Riga, that their intention was to exterminate the Jews. And his motto was that he would fight against them. And he said it was better to die a brave man than to be killed as a coward. And he carried himself with a great deal of self-confidence, and he had an athletic step to him. And this angered an SS man in Riga, whose last name was Hoffman. And Hoffman was determined to destroy Schapau. Whenever he would encounter Schapau on the street, he would hit him with a stick or a whip, and he would try to humiliate him. He'd force him to get down on the ground and kiss the sidewalk, and just treated him terribly. And one day he marched Schapau back to Schapau's small house, and he had Schapau stand up against a wall, spread eagle, the way you may have seen a police do with a suspect, where they have their arms and their legs outstretched against a wall. And Schapau turned his head slightly to look at Hoffman, and he saw that Hoffman was unholstering a Luger pistol. And he suddenly realized that Hoffman was going to shoot and kill him. He quickly turned around and, with a very fierce blow, knocked Hoffman out. And he then grabbed Hoffman's gun, and he was going to kill him, but then realized that the sound of gunfire would attract other SS men, and they would come in and arrest him. So instead, he took a lamp off a bureau and used the base of the lamp to bludgeon Hoffman, and he beat in Hoffman's skull and killed him. He then wrapped Hoffman's body in a shroud and waited until about 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, and dragged Hoffman's body into an alley and left it there, and then snuck back to his own home. He hoped that Hoffman's body would not be discovered for several days. Unfortunately, two SS men discovered it the following morning, and they rounded up 25,000 Jews of Riga, and they brought them into the town square. And they said that if the person who committed this crime didn't step forward and confess, that they were going to hang two innocent men. Well, Schapau was standing there, and he had a terrible dilemma. Do I step forward and confess and be killed? Or do I let two innocent men be hanged? He decided not to step forward, and two innocent men were brought forward, and they were hanged, and their bodies were left dangling for days in the town square. It was a terrible trauma for him, and he felt guilty about this for the rest of his life. During this period of time, the SS guards also rounded up 25,000 Jews from Riga, and they took them to a place called the Rumbela Forest, where they machine gunned all 25,000 of the Jews. Schapau managed to escape that as well, and he was sent to a concentration camp called Kaiserwald. And there, because of his athletic abilities, he was put to work boxing for the entertainment of the SS guards. And they put him into a ring with a man who had been a middleweight boxing champion, a man named Werner Samuel. And Chappell managed to beat him. And this angered the guards once again. And they had him shipped to another concentration camp called Stutthof. And this was a crueler camp, if you can believe it, than the one than Kaiserwald. And the guards there were so vicious and nasty that when the Jews were forced off the trains that brought them to the camp, they used to sing this song to the Jews as they got off the train. They would sing, "Jews go through the Red Sea, the waves close in, and the world is happy. Jews are drowned." And once again, he was forced to fight for his survival there, which he continued to do. From there, he was fortunate. He got shipped to another camp called Magdeburg. And the reason he got shipped there is because the commandant from that camp came to Stutthof and asked if there were any men who had been trained and worked as engineers before the war. Chappell figured this is a way to survive again. And so he said that he had been trained as an engineer. He was shipped to Magdeburg, but not given any engineering duties. Instead, he had to sweep floors and clean grease from garage floors. And by the time that camp was to be evacuated as allies were approaching, the camp was surrounded, I believe, on three sides by water. And they tried to put all the Jews into boats so they could evacuate them that way. However, there weren't enough boats. So they forced 50,000 Jews into the water around the camp, and then they machine gunned all 50,000 of them. Well, during this a terrible ordeal, Chappell and several other men managed to beat up an SS guard, and they stole his uniform, and they each took part of the uniform and dressed in it, and they escaped. And Chappell was able to escape to Allied lines, and there he was thought to be a member of the SS because he was wearing an SS guard's jacket, and he couldn't speak English. He could speak Yiddish, and none of the Americans could speak Yiddish. However, the Americans did find a GI who spoke Yiddish, and he interviewed Chappell and determined that Chappell, in fact, had been an inmate at the camp. And from there, Chappell went into a DP camp, displaced persons camp, for a brief period of time, and then sailed to what was then called Mandate Palestine. And one day he's walking through the streets of Jerusalem, and he encountered a man who had stolen money from his mother and his brother. It was money that was to be used for documents to get them out of Riga. And this man stole their money. And as a result, Chappell's mother was killed in Riga. When he encountered this man in Jerusalem, he beat him into unconsciousness. He didn't kill him, but he left him bloody in an alley. And he was an ardent Zionist, which was part of his training in the Maccabee Boxing Club. And he joined the Ergon, which was the first underground army in Mandate Palestine. And then during the War of Independence, he joined the IDF. And when the war was over, he met a woman who became his wife. A woman that they married, and they moved to Chicago. From Chicago, they moved to Los Angeles, where he opened a very successful trucking company and had two children, a son and a daughter, named Mike and Adina. And I was very fortunate to have been able to interview his son, Mike, who gave me a great deal of information about his father's experiences in the concentration camps. The next man I wrote about was a Greek a Jew who became the middleweight boxing champion of Greece when he was only between the ages of 16 and 17, just going on to his 17th birthday. His name was Salomo Arouk, and he was from Salonika. And Salonika had the largest Jewish population of any city in Greece. It was 35% Jewish, and so much so that on Saturday, the Sabbath, the whole town closed down. Gentiles and Jews had the day off on that day. And when the Italians invaded Greece, the Greek volunteers were able to fight them off and drive the Italians out. And this was very upsetting to Hitler. And so the Wehrmacht was next sent into to Greece, and they conquered Greece. And they particularly wanted to get rid of the Jews of Salonika. And so they sent a very, very vicious man named Alois Brunner, who after the war was tried as a war criminal for all the thousands of Jews that he killed and sent to concentration camps. He managed to escape prosecution, and he went to Syria after the war, where he joined the Ba'ath Party, became a friend of Assad, and his job in Syria was to train the Syrian army about how best to torture, capture Israeli soldiers, and then to execute them, and that's what he did. But on March 15th, 1943, Aruk, his father, his mother, sisters, and brother all arrived at Auschwitz. His father, his mother, and his sisters were immediately gassed and killed. His brother was told to remove the gold fillings from the teeth of Jews who had been gassed, and he refused to do that. So he was immediately shot in the head and killed. They told Aruk the same fate would be his unless he were to box as well. And the first person they put him in the ring with was an enormous Czech fighter, and Aruk managed to beat him. So they figured that we'll get an even bigger, stronger fighter to fight him. And they brought in a German fighter named Klaus Silber, who had won 100 fights before this. And Aruk beat him as well. And by this point, you know, Aruk was quite emaciated and living on just scraps of food. And Silber was a big, strong guy. But Aruk knew that his life depended on it, that if he didn't beat Silber, he would be dragged off to a gas chamber and killed. And after he defeated Silber, Silber was the one who was dragged off and never seen again. And it was estimated that he was either shot or thrown into one of the gas chambers. After the war, like Schapau, Aruk went to Mandate Palestine. He joined the IDF. He fought in the Israeli War of Independence. And then he also fought in the Six-Day War in 1967. He married, had a family, had a successful shipping business in Israel, and he died of a stroke in 2009. The next person I wrote about was not a Jewish fighter. He was a Sintai, which is a form of a gypsy. Sintai in Roma do not like the word gypsy. It's not only colloquial, but they think it's derogatory. So this fellow, his name was Johann Trollmann, and he was a Sintai. He was a very swarthy looking individual. He had long black curly hair, jet black hair, and he had to go to a public school with German kids, and most of whom were very fair looking, blonde, sandy haired kids. And they all made fun of him and they picked on him. So his father sent him to a boxing gym to learn to box. And he became quite proficient at this and eventually was trained by the leading Jewish boxing champion of Germany in the late 1920s, early 1930s, a man named Erich Seelig, who ultimately was driven out of Germany by the Nazis and his title was taken away from him because he was Jewish. But Trollmann was a brilliant, brilliant boxer. He was very quick on his feet and would dance around the ring so that an opponent couldn't hit him. He fought very much like Muhammad Ali would fight many years later. That expression, float like a butterfly, sting like a bee, would be appropriate for Trollmann. That's exactly how he fought. And it was very difficult for his opponents to hit him. And he fought the light heavyweight champion of Germany, a man named Adolf Witt, and soundly beat him and got the title of light heavyweight champion of Germany. However, the Nazi Boxing Commission was very upset about this. And the next day they took away his title. Well, this caused an uproar amongst the population at that time. They thought even though he was a Sintai, that he had won fair and square and he should have the title. So they gave the title back to him. And then they took it away again. And they told him he would have to fight Adolf Witt one more time. But this time he'd have to fight in the German style of fighting, which was flat-footed and standing in the center of the ring and trading punch for punch with a German boxer. But he also had a sense of humor about this. And before the fight, he dyed his jet black hair all blonde, very shiny blonde. And he covered his body in white baking powder. And he entered the ring as a parody of an Aryan. And this caused a great deal of laughter, even amongst the Nazis who were attending the fight. And he stood in the ring and he fought the way he was instructed to. And it would have been impossible to determine who the winner was because they just kept trading punches. But nevertheless, Adolf Witt was rewarded with the light heavyweight championship again. After Trollmann lost that fight, he was drafted into the Wehrmacht and sent to the Eastern Front, where he was badly wounded. His wounds were so bad that he was sent home to recover. But while he was home, he was dishonorably discharged. And then the Wehrmacht went ahead and they dishonorably discharged all members of the Wehrmacht who were Sinti or Roma, because they felt that they were subhuman and they were not up to fighting at the same level as the Wehrmacht was. Once he was dishonorably discharged, he was sent to a concentration camp. And the camp he was sent to was called the Neuengamme concentration camp. And there it wasn't discovered initially that he had been a boxer, and he was badly beaten by the guards on a regular basis. They hated him for being what they called a mongrel gypsy. And his friends in the camp felt so badly that the guards would eventually kill him, that when another inmate died, they gave that inmate Johann's name, and they gave Johann the dead inmate's name. When the ersatz Johann was cremated, they sent Johann's family a bill for the cremation. But they realized that Johann would eventually be discovered, so they arranged for him to be sent to another concentration camp, the Wittenberg camp. And there it was discovered that he was a boxer, and he was forced to box, and he had numerous fights, and he won all of them. But there was a very vicious capo at that camp named Emil Cornelius, who used to take a great deal of pleasure in beating up the inmates. And he was, the guards told him that he should fight Johann Trollmann and beat him and show him who the real superior person was. Well, it didn't work out that way. Trollmann viciously beat Emil Cornelius, humiliated him, and Cornelius was furious. As a capo, he was able to give Trollmann really backbreaking work for several days. And while he was doing this backbreaking work, he would hit him over the back with a stick. And this went on for days on end. And finally, he had enough. And Cornelius snuck up behind Trollmann one day with a club and beat him to death, crushed his skull and beat him to death. Trollmann was only 36 years old. The next person is someone I mentioned at the beginning of my talk, Harry Haft, who was from Poland. And he was a young man when he was sent to Auschwitz. He had he was just in his last years of his 16th year, the last months of his 16th year. And before he had been sent to Auschwitz, an SS soldier in his town grabbed him and pushed his hand into a doorway, pressed his fingers up against the door jamb, and then slammed the door against all the fingers in his hand and broke every single finger. He was sent to Auschwitz And his job there was taking the dead bodies from the ovens and from the gas chambers and putting them into the ovens to be incinerated. And one day he was lifting a body off a wheelbarrow, and he noticed that the man's eyes were open. The man was still alive. He hadn't been killed by the gas. And he didn't want to toss this man into the ovens. And a guard standing by said, "If you don't, I'm going to shoot you." So he had no choice but to throw the man in into the oven. And after he shut the door, he heard screams coming from him. A few minutes later, he wound up tossing the man's wife into the same oven. Fortunately for her, she was dead at the time. But this was a terrible trauma for Harry Haft, and it stayed with him for the rest of his life. He had 76 fights when he was in Auschwitz, and he won every single one of them. In one night alone, he was forced to fight six other men. Now, you know, a professional boxer may have one fight a month or one fight every 2 months, but for a man who's nearly starving to death, to have six fights in one night was extraordinary punishment. And the fact that he was able to win all six of them shows the desperation with which he fought. And he and another man managed to steal SS guard uniforms one night, and they escaped from the camp. However, they were followed by guards who were alerted to their escape, and they jumped into a ditch as the guards were firing rifles and machine guns at them. Harry went in first, and his friend went in on top of him. And two guards approached the ditch, and one guard was going to fire his gun into the ditch, and the other one said, "Don't waste your bullets, they're already dead," and they left. And that's how Harry Haft survived. He waited until about 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, and he got up out of that ditch, and he walked and walked for miles. He really didn't know where he was going. But he came to a river, and at the banks of the river, he saw there was a uniform for an SS guard and a rifle. And then he looked into the river, and he saw that the man to whom these garments belonged was bathing. And the man called out to him in German. And Harry Haft responded, and the guard who was bathing realized that Harry was Jewish, and he yelled something about dirty Juden, and Harry immediately grabbed the guy's gun as the guy was rushing out of the river, and Harry shot and killed him, and then used the rifle butt to crush his skull. He donned the man's uniform and had the same experience that Chapow did as he made his way to Allied lines. He was thought to be a German soldier. And it took once again an American soldier who could speak Yiddish to interview him and discover that he was really a Polish Jew who had been an inmate at the camps. He eventually had some fights in a DP camp for the entertainment of this time for the American soldiers, though he was well fed and well treated, and he seemed to enjoy doing that. And he sailed to Brooklyn after the war and moved in with cousins. And since he had been locked up since he was 16 years old, he didn't have much of an education. He could neither read nor write. He spoke broken English after being here for a while. And he decided that he would have a career as a boxer. That's all that he knew. He had boxed a few years in Auschwitz, and he was good at it. So he was able to hire a boxing manager, named Mandel, and Mandel set him up with some amateur bouts, and then got him some professional bouts. And he was coming along quite well. And Mandel decided that perhaps he should have a fight with a really up and coming professional. That up and coming professional would eventually become the heavyweight champion of the world. But this was on July 18th, 1949, the man that he was scheduled to fight was Rocky Marciano. And before the fight, three mafioso came into Harry Haft's dressing room, and they told him that if he didn't lose the fight, they would kill him. And he knew they were telling the truth, because just 4 weeks earlier, they had killed another man who refused to take a dive in a fight. So Harry Haft was knocked out in the third round of that fight, and he never fought again. He opened a fruit and vegetable store in Brooklyn. He was a very embittered man, traumatized by what he had witnessed and had to participate in Auschwitz. He was furious that the only career that he could have had was taken away from him in the land of the free and the brave after surviving 76 fights in Auschwitz. And he mistreated his sons and his wife. He was not a good father or a good husband. And I interviewed his son, Alan Haft, who sent me a letter that he wrote to his father, because eventually his sons realized the terrible traumas that their father had gone through, and they understood what motivated him to behave the way he did. And I'd like to read to you the letter that Alan wrote to his father. "Dear Popsy, you have been gone nearly 12 years, and I miss not having a father. Growing up, you beat me for my childish behavior. The rage you had inside you often took out on me. I feared your very presence. You broke furniture and punched out windows, abused Mom to no end. Despite the abuse, Mom always protected you, excused your behavior because of your background. I could not excuse you until I learned what that background was. I was ashamed of you. You could not read or write. You spoke broken English with a thick accent and those green numbers on your arm. I wish I knew then what I know now. You suffered terribly at the hands of the Nazis. You saw horror and were forced to participate in it. After you told me all about your ordeal, what you had to do just to live another day, it helped me to understand why you were who you were and are who you are. I now see how sorry you are for the abuse. How can anyone judge you? They call you a Holocaust survivor, but does anyone really survive? It has been said that the Nazis murdered your soul. Popsy, I have spent my later years trying to make the world better for you. Your story was published by Syracuse University. You were inducted into the Jewish Sports Hall of Fame. There is a major motion picture about your life. I know you would have been happy that I made you famous. Despite the physical and psychological abuse, I would want you to know I forgive you. Mom died this summer. She was the angel sent by God to care for you. Now it's your turn to take care of her. Love, Alan." I found that a very poignant, a very touching letter, and very instrumental that his son, both of his sons, could finally forgive their father when they were able to understand everything that the father had gone through. The next section of my book deals with two men who managed to escape from Auschwitz. One was a man named Rudy Verba, who was a biochemist, became a very successful biochemist researcher after the war, and had a special clinic first in London and then in Ottawa. And another man who escaped with him, they managed to write the first report about the killing of Hungarian Jews in Auschwitz. And they were able to smuggle the report to a Jewish ambassador from South America. He was the ambassador to Switzerland. And all the Swiss newspapers published his report. And as a result of this, there were massive demonstrations in Switzerland against the carryings on, the atrocities that were going on in Auschwitz. And this report made its way to the desk of Franklin Roosevelt, who had previously not permitted the bombing of the railroad tracks leading into the concentration camps. But upon reading this report, he contacted the Nazi puppet head of Hungary and told him that if any more Hungarian Jews were sent to Auschwitz, that the American Air Force would bomb all the Nazi and Hungarian military installations in and around Budapest. And that saved the lives of 100,000 Hungarians in Budapest. Unfortunately, hundreds of thousands of other Hungarians from the countryside had been shipped to Auschwitz and were killed. The other man, who is really an unsung hero of World War II. He was a Polish Catholic cavalry officer named Witold Pilecki, who had heard what was going on in Auschwitz and at first didn't believe it, but then felt that he had to learn for himself what was going on. And he put himself in a position of being arrested and sent to Auschwitz. And from Auschwitz, he wrote these very lengthy reports. He also, with several other Polish inmates, managed to piece together the pieces for a shortwave radio and send information to the exiled Polish army in London. And that report also made its way, unfortunately, not until after the war, but Witold escaped with three other prisoners after serving in Auschwitz for 2.5 years, made his way back to Warsaw, where he rejoined the Polish Home Army and fought against the Nazis. And when the Russians came in, he was declared an enemy of the state, because as much as he was an anti-Nazi, he was also an anti-communist. And he was arrested by the Russians. He was put in prison. He was tortured. They pulled out all of his fingernails and did other things to torture him. And they forced him to confess to being a traitor. And then they executed him. And he became a non-person in Poland until after the Russians left. Now he's celebrated as a hero in Poland. The next section of my book deals with a man named Abba Kovner, who is from Vilna. And when the Nazis took over Vilna, he realized that the Nazis were going to exterminate all the Jews there. And he wrote a report entitled, "Let Us Not Go Like Sheep to the Slaughter, Let Us Fight." And the vast majority of Jews in Vilna refused to believe that there was anything like what he said the Nazis would do to them. And unfortunately, many of them died as a result of that. But he was able to gather up around himself about 250 men and women who armed themselves with often stolen Nazi equipment, and they bombed railroad trains and assassinated individual Nazis. And then they joined up with Russian partisans to fight against the Nazis, and then went off on their own. And during the last 2 years of the war, and up until about 1950, these 250 men and women, known as the Avengers, or Nakam in Hebrew, they managed to kill 1,500 Nazi war criminals. These were men who had escaped prosecution because they were not well known as Nazi war criminals. And what the Avengers would do is they would often disguise themselves after the war as British military men. And they had a British military car, and they would drive to the homes of these unprosecuted Nazi war criminals. And they would say they were wanted for interrogation at a British command post. And the Nazi war criminal would reluctantly go with them. And then they would drive the war criminal to the woods. They'd drag him out of the car. He knew what was going to happen to him. They'd force him to kneel, and they'd say, "Now justice is going to be done to you." And they would shoot him in the head and kill him. After 1950, the group pretty much disbanded. Abba Kovner went to Israel. He not only testified in the trial against Adolf Eichmann, but he also became the leading poet of Israel. If there was such a thing as a poet laureate of Israel, it would have been Abba Kovner. And their mission was replaced by another 250 men, all members of Mossad, who hunted down and killed another 2,000 Nazi war criminals, one of whom was a man named Herbert Kukers, who was known as the hangman of Riga. He had killed thousands and thousands of tens of thousands of Jews. And he was hunted down in South America and executed. And after he was executed, the Mossad agents who killed him, they actually sent out a press release to newspapers all around the world, alerting them to the fact that this man had been killed and justice had been done. And my book concludes finally with the trials of Nazi war criminals, some of whom were well known, some of whom were not well known, some of whom were just guards at the camps, but some of these guards were really vicious, horrible human beings. And that's the story of my book. If you have any questions, I would be very happy to answer your questions. Here's what the book looks like. It's called Holocaust Fighters, Boxers, Resistors, and Avengers. And I hope that you will read it. It's available at Amazon.com and BarnesandNoble.com. Thank you for listening to me. I can't hear you, Justin.
I forgot to unmute myself. There must be questions because there was so much there. Does anyone want to unmute themselves and ask anything? I have a question.
Sure.
Can you explain how you got into this? You know, what was the entry point for this that got you involved in this research?
Well, I had encountered a story about Harry Haft. His son had written about him, and I found the story fascinating. And I wanted to know if there were other men who were forced to box for the entertainment of SS guards in other camps. And yes, there were. And it was extraordinary to me that these SS guards were so vicious that they couldn't wait to see these people kill each other. It was like a dog fights or bear baiting. It was just horrible. And these men took such pleasure that they would drink champagne and laugh and celebrate, and for them it was just a good time. They were totally incapable of any kind of empathy for what they saw before them. For them, these were just animals killing each other. And you know, a normal person wouldn't want to see dogs doing this to each other, never mind human beings. So it's really kind of mind-boggling how people could tolerate this and take pleasure in it.
There is a comment from Bonnie. She said, it's hard to believe that these atrocities happened less than 100 years ago. Do you worry that conditions could arise again that allow such immoral behavior?
Yeah, I think it can. You know, I have a quote in the introduction of my book. It's from a play by Bertolt Brecht, which I'd like to read to you. It's from a play called The Resistible Rise of Arturo Uy, and he wrote, "If we could learn to look instead of gawking, we'd see the horror in the heart of farce. If only we could act instead of talking, we wouldn't always end up on our arse. This was the thing that nearly had us mastered. Don't yet rejoice in his defeat, you men. Although the world stood up and stopped the bastard, the bitch that bore him is in heat again." So yes, he thought it certainly could happen. And I guess, you know, one of the things we learned from history is that people are capable of the most cruel kind of behavior. And it's up to other people to stop them. You know, nobody wanted to stop the Nazis in the 1930s. Nobody wanted to prevent the Holocaust. There was even a conference in Evian, France in the 1930s about what we should do about this, and they all came to the conclusion we should do nothing. And it was just extraordinary. And every, you know, Western European country was represented there, including the United States. It was just amazing.
It is amazing. There were so many stories in your book. Each one of them could be a book. It's just remarkable. And the part that I was struck by was not just the cruelty, which is hard to even conceive of, but also the courage and the fortitude of these people that fought back.
It's extraordinary. I mean, that you know, I had my father was an amateur boxer, and I've known boxers, and I never got into a boxing ring, but I know people that did, and you know, for the people who are in the best of condition, it takes a great deal of courage to get into a boxing ring and put yourself in that position, to be malnourished and sickly, and to know that you're fighting for your life, and that if you don't win, you're going to be killed. I mean, the anxiety and the nervousness and the worry that must accompany that is just almost indescribable.
It really is. And you think, you know, they're eating broth or a crust of bread. And I mean, how do they even have the, it's It's remarkable. Bonnie said the strength of these men is something that stands in the face of this. I agree.
I agree too.
John Kerr said, it must have been very difficult to conduct your research. How did you actually do it?
While I was doing a lot of the research and the writing, I found myself getting very depressed about these stories. There was no sort of joy in writing about it. Even in writing the final chapter about the prosecution of these people, I had to relive the crimes that they committed, which is what got them sentenced at the end. But I felt compelled that this story should be told, because I think it's important. And other people who are historians about the Holocaust. I was interviewed by three Holocaust centers so far about this book, and the three people who interviewed me, they all have PhDs in history, and none of them really knew anything about what these boxers had to endure in the concentration camps. So, yeah. So I feel that I've brought to public awareness something that people hadn't been aware of before.
It's very exciting. It's a hidden piece of history, and so much has been written about the Holocaust, but I have never seen anything on this topic.
Exactly.
Really interesting.
And one person I told this to, he said to me, well, what more is there to write about the Holocaust? It's all been done before. And I said, well, did you ever hear of the boxers who had to fight for their lives in the concentration camps? And he said, no, I never heard of that.
It's really amazing. Bonnie says, thank you for bringing this to light. And I concur that it is really fascinating. And it's so poignant. And hearing that letter was really very poignant.
And there's a movie about Harry Haft that Barry Levinson just completed. And it HBO bought it. So I expect that it's going to be on HBO sometime later this year.
Oh, that's great. We'll have to watch for that.
It's called Survivor.
Survivor. Okay. We'll watch for it. And I mean, it seems like so many of those stories could be blockbuster films. They're just epic stories. Absolutely
right.
Epic.
There's a documentary, it's only in French, about Victor Perez, and it's called Searching for Victor Perez, and it's trying to uncover what his life was and so forth. There were very few people around who still remember him. There were a few relatives, and it was interesting because a friend of mine who speaks French was able to translate much of the movie for me. And then there was there's an Israeli movie also about him, but it's only in Hebrew, and I don't think it has subtitles.
Oh, that makes it difficult.
So that would be difficult to watch.
Yeah. Oh, well, this has been absolutely fascinating. Does anyone else have anything to ask or to comment on? No? Okay. Well, thank you so much. This has been really, really fascinating, Jeffrey, and much success with the book. And thank you everyone for coming tonight. And as I said before, if you know anyone that couldn't come, I know there were a lot of people that couldn't, we will put this on YouTube so that they can see it. So thank you everybody, and good night.
And thank you for having me. It was a pleasure.
Our pleasure. Thank you so much. Good night, everybody.
Bye-bye. Stay well.
You too.